Hello guys, Winston here. Nearly 3 years ago, I began moving my shop out of my aunt's garage and into a house of my own. And in the course of disassembling my personal CNC router for transport, I vowed to take its bones and build it into a stronger, more capable machine. That process took way longer than expected because, you know, life. But I never stopped toying around with ideas for it in my head. And eventually, I pulled together the pieces I needed to make it happen. So without further ado, let me introduce you to the Frankenoko. This is what happens when you take the extrusions from an old Shapeoko 3 XL, salvage a threaded table upgrade from a Shapeoko 3 standard, design some custom plates, pair it all with 4th generation Shapeoko hardware, and then spice it up a little bit. You get a light-duty CNC router that's surprisingly robust and perfect for some weekend woodworking. It's got a cutting area just shy of 30 inches wide and a little over 18 inches deep, a slight reduction in width compared to the Shapeoko 3 XL, but an increase in usable depth. With a 65mm VFD spindle, it wields precision and power without the high RPM wail of a compact router. The Frankenoko has a salvaged Shapeoko 4 bit setter affixed to a custom low-profile mount to keep it out of the way of most operations. LED strips are mounted on all three X and Y axis extrusions to illuminate the work area. The extra flicker-free fill lighting on the machine's bed makes filming marginally easier, even though, admittedly, its true purpose is just to look cool. The Shapeoko 3's drivetrain with its 9mm belts has been swapped out in favor of the 15mm belts on 4th generation machines, and despite needing larger pulleys for these belts, bending loads on the stepper motor shaft is reduced thanks to what I would consider to be innovative placement of the stepper motors. Less stress on the motor's bearings should translate to a longer service life. Key components of the Frankenoko's frame are laser-cut steel. It might not be as sexy as machined aluminum, but it's affordable, easily scalable, and allows the plates to be reversible since I'm tapping them rather than using PEM nuts. Shout out to Fabworks, by the way, for cutting out these gantry end plates for me. They got these parts laser cut and powder coated for me within a couple days, and they even tapped some of the holes for me, saving me more time. These ended up fitting the Frankenoko like a glove. 10 out of 10, would recommend. The end plates I designed are symmetrical, which allows me to use the same part on both sides of the gantry. And because I'm mounting all of my electronics on the moving parts of the machine, wiring is both simplified and future-proofed. For example, it would be trivial for me to install a second proximity switch on the left side of my machine, steal a Shapeoko 5 controller, and implement dual Y-axis homing down the road to auto-square my gantry every time I started up the machine. Cable management has been dramatically overhauled. It's not quite to the standards of the Shapeoko 4 and 5, which routes the spindle power cables separately from the rest of the electronics wiring, but it's way better than the setup on the Shapeoko 3, where some critical parts of the drag chain and its supports were secured with double-sided tape. I have a custom 3D printed bracket that handles the transition between the gantry and the Y-axis drag chains. And the Y-axis drag chain is terminated into the floor of my enclosure, saving me from having to incorporate an extra sheet metal wing in my design. The electronics are mounted outside the enclosure for cleanliness and ease of access. The V-wheels, traditionally seen as the weakest link on a Shapeoko, have been doubled up on the X-axis to make that interface more rigid. This is where the majority of the deflection comes from on a Shapeoko 3 or 4, so this actually changes the character of the machine appreciably for very little cost. And, to improve the reliability of the V-wheels, I've designed guards for the X-axis carriage to prevent chips from being flung right between the V-wheels and the rail. It also wipes off larger chips that might cling to the gantry rail. This happens a lot when you're machining plastics. If you're not diligently using dust collection, you can quickly get into a situation where the wheels can get jammed. I wouldn't go so far as to say this is the pinnacle of V-wheel and belt-driven Shapeoko design, but I think it's pretty close. Now, in addition to improvements on the machine side of things, I also decided to take some time to deal with minor annoyances around working with my CNC. Because having a good time using a machine is arguably as important as having a good machine, and my CNC enclosure that I designed 5 years ago has its share of flaws. Let me briefly mention some of the small changes I've made. 1. Chips used to pile up inside the doors, and when I opened the enclosure, they'd come tumbling out. That, I guess, isn't just a past tense thing, I didn't actually fix that, but I did print out a lip to catch chips that do escape containment. As someone who isn't a sociopath like Alex from I Did A Thing, this makes working in the garage either barefoot or in socks much more bearable. 2. I used to have a hinged arm cut from 2x4s to suspend a vacuum hose above my work area. It performed okay, but unless I used it with this super flexible hose from Rockler, which by the way is delightfully stretchy, it was quite annoying to try to grab the hose to clean up the enclosure after a project. Balancing the slack needed to keep it out of the way of the machine while still allowing me to reach all the nooks and crannies around the enclosure was nearly impossible. This time around, I've decided to secure a fixed length of hose to the inside of my enclosure and use a heavy-duty retractable lanyard to manage the free slack. This particular model I found on Amazon has a magnet that takes the stress off the flat coil spring inside the device when it's fully retracted. We'll see how long this lasts, but so far I like it. 3. In addition to improving vacuum hose management inside the enclosure, I've decided to design and print a splitter so I can effortlessly swap between using the dust boot and cleaning up around the garage. There's some other vacuum-related optimizations too, like this U-bend for my dust deputy and a custom sweepy adapter, but the splitter and gate assembly is what I'm most pleased with. 4. To enhance my enjoyment while cosplaying as a machinist, I hooked up a touchscreen to my enclosure. This gives me a way to easily adjust feed rate or pause a program without needing to keep a mouse within arm's reach. On my old setup, I kept a mouse right here. That made it really annoying to assume the machinist stance and hover the mouse cursor over the pause button in carbide motion. And by adding a sliding keyboard under the enclosure, I now have the option to type freely and jog the machine without showering the keys in aluminum. And 5. I took the power button harness from an XXL Shapeoko 4, which typically runs inside the Y-axis extrusion, and used its length to move the power button for the machine to the front of my enclosure, making it infinitely easier to kill power in an emergency. Now, everything I just said is great in theory, but right now it is still just that, a theory. The Frankenoko needs to be tested. Lucky for me, while I was procrastinating on this project for way too long, my wife was busy accumulating a list of things she needed me to make. And you know what? I actually think these projects will provide a decent shakedown test for the Frankenoko. Let's get started on knocking out this list so I can recover some domestic harmony points, and so I can get on with making the things I want to make. The first thing on the list was a trivet for scented candles. The scented candles my wife has are 4 inches in diameter. The glass for these things gets pretty warm when the candle burns down and saturates the thermal mass of the remaining wax. Now, my wife, having considered both the thermal implications of supporting a candle, as well as my particular neuroses with regards to overcomplicating things, handed me a piece of aluminum and said, "Go to town." It wasn't ideal because the plate was only about as wide as the candle's diameter, but she was okay with me fudging the form factor of the trivet as long as it still nailed the functional requirements, and this is what I came up with. For toolpathing, I dropped an adaptive toolpath over everything, and then used a ball nose end mill to clean up all the 3D surfaces. On the flat areas, I specifically wanted to leverage a spiral toolpath to try and create a ripple effect in the floor. And then I'd use a 16th inch end mill to pocket out the hibiscus design. At the Frankenoko, to avoid accidentally cutting into my table, which I wasn't yet emotionally prepared for, and to create a perfectly leveled work area, I stuck a chunk of 2x4 on the bed and machined the top face of it. On top of that, I could tape down my aluminum plate and then get to work. For aluminum roughing, I'm starting with comparable speeds and feeds to what I've used before on the original Shapeoko 3 in the past. And the first impressions are that I could definitely push it harder. But since I'm using adhesive work holding without air blast, I don't want to risk building up any heat in the part. A more extreme test will have to wait. Like I said, this is just a shakedown project. Next, it was time to 3D finish the trivet. And again, comparing how this went versus my experience 3D finishing, say, a big fat aluminum longboard, I'd say this machine is definitely more rigid overall. There are still certain directions of cutting where the reaction force is kicked into the spindle in a way that creates the possibility of chatter. I could hear this start to happen when I was climb cutting on the left side of features. The direction of force meant the cutter was trying to apply a positive torque to the Z-axis about the gantry rail. This is historically probably one of the most common modal weak points of most gantry designs, but at the end of the day, if you back off on the speeds and feeds, you can usually work around this. When it came time to pocket in the hibiscus design, I loaded up a number 112 16th inch flat end mill and let the machine go to town. With a belt-based machine, I've never had any problems going down to a 132nd inch end mill in aluminum. You can theoretically get into situations where the resolution of the drivetrain causes the motion to be jerky at the microscopic level, which might overstress really tiny cutters. But for general purpose machining, the Frankenoko should be able to handle everything I want to throw at it. The finished trivet is basically what I expected it to be, although the step over for the spiral toolpath should have been larger. The ripple effect I was going for ended up being too subtle. But this is a good learning experience I can apply to future projects. For now, let's just bead blast the whole thing, slap some cork on the bottom, and move on. Project 2 is a floating picture frame, and this is going to be a hybrid CNC and 3D printing project. First, I designed this frame in Fusion 360. These plastic bezels were modeled with M200 threads and they screw together to compress an acrylic sandwich. I have some leftover 1/8 inch acrylic I can machine with a plastic optimized end mill, and I'll secure this to my CNC with some double-sided tape. The cutout discs dropped perfectly into my 3D printed frame, and then I stuck the frame into a simple wooden pedestal. Project 3. The wife wanted to make some edge-lit signs for our niece, so I had her put together some projects in Carbide Create, and then we got ready to cut and engrave some acrylic. But this time, I threw down an MDF table protector on the machine first. I bolted the MDF onto the Frankenoko, surfaced it, and then let my wife loose on the machine. Drag engraving projects with small stepovers and long runtimes are a good test of a machine's repeatability. And the Frankenoko performed admirably, as expected. We also did some variations that were rotary engraved. The end results were all Nice approved. Okay, home stretch. Last project before I have some wife-free playtime with the CNC. A coworker recently became a dad, and she wanted to make his newborn a name sign. So I fired up the Frankenoko again and had it cut out a 16-inch diameter circle of plywood. Quarter-inch compression bit, 3mm step down, no problems. And with a surfaced wasteboard, I was able to cut down to just a couple fibers short of perfection. A quick pass with a knife let me lift away the excess stock. Finally, the slate is clear. In between all of these side projects, I did find time to do some testing of my own. For example, I threw a McFly cutter in the spindle to see how trammed my spindle was. And in doing so, I accidentally maxed out the machine by sinking the surfacing bit nearly a quarter inch deep in some moderately hard wood. It was only supposed to cut 0.6 millimeters deep, but I forgot the decimal point when I typed in the value. The machine handled it quite well, all things considered. It even pushed the cutter hard enough to bog down the spindle. Not too bad for a belt-driven machine. Now, to be clear, the Frankenoko is not free of flaws, and it's not magically as rigid as a linear rail machine despite my best efforts. But it is enough of an improvement over the Shapeoko 3 baseline that I am genuinely happy about how it performs. There will always be room down the road to dial things up a notch and do crazier and wilder things with more power, more rigidity, more speed, but at the end of the day, the most important thing for me is just that the Frankenoko works. Electrically, everything checks out. It's holding reasonable tolerances, features like the bit setter work, and the refurbished VFD that I took possession of functions as expected. I think it's safe to say the Frankenoko is ready for action, and I consider the project overall a success. And on top of that, I'm thrilled about the quality of life improvements I've made to the enclosure. I know that usually tackling small, nagging, tangentially related problems is rarely something anyone would consider to be an essential objective in a project. But pausing and letting yourself throw a couple brain cycles at annoyances like this can be surprisingly therapeutic. Anyway, I want to thank you all very much for watching. With this machine finally operational, I can finally say, in good conscience, that I'll be back soon with some actual CNC projects rather than Project CNC content.